Greetings. My name is Joshua Bynus, and I'm the Industry Foresight Lead within the Corporate Strategy Organization at the Bonneville Power Administration. The following presentation is part 5 of a 7-part video series focused on exploring the long-term electric power industry landscape. If you haven't already, please take a few minutes to view the introduction to the series for some valuable context. Hopefully, you'll find the time spent viewing this video to be valuable. Please feel free to send me an email with any feedback. Enjoy. Flat to declining regional loads may be the norm until transportation's electrified or populations significantly increase. And over the last 20 years, loads have pretty much been seeming to be flat. They've actually grown a little bit, but energy efficiency took care of the need. One of the big drivers for that is that there have been a lot of federal standards that were put in place, I think 36 or more under the Obama administration for appliances, and that's helping ratchet down future load growth. But wider energy efficiency efforts have also been put into play. Those are having impact. And I'll just back up a second. When I say flat to declining regional loads may be the norm until populations significantly increase, we've had a fair amount of population increase over the last 20 years in the Pacific Northwest, and loads have still, with energy efficiency incorporated, been fairly flat over that time. So I guess what I'm pointing out here is that for population to be the driver of load growth, we would have to see a real boom in population, or just a massive uptick influx of people into the Northwest, way beyond just the normative population increase. Now, that said, when we look at the impact that the federal appliance standards are having, those are certainly having some effect. But also, when we look at how this is all getting tabulated by the Northwest Power and Conservation Council, for example, and you look at a comparison between their load growth forecasts in the 6th power plan versus the 7th power plan, which maybe for those of you outside of the Northwest region, that is a plan that comes out every 5 years to help guide the region. The 7th power plan's high load forecast is still lower than the low load forecast of the 6th power plan. And once you take energy efficiency into account, then you actually start looking at some negative load growth out until about 2030. We're expecting that to put some pressure on retail utilities in regard to revenue, and it rolls up, even to wholesale purchases as well. Now, what's driving some of that? EPRI has shared a lot of different end use in the home where we're seeing reduction from space heat to lighting that are pretty significant out to 2030. And this is their view of residential. Similarly, there's a lot of reductions in commercial uses as well. Also, as one of the factors driving this, we're seeing new financing mechanisms develop to support energy efficiency investment. PACE loans, for example, property assessed clean energy loans, have become much more popular in the last couple years after kind of making it through a little bit of a hurdle that they had at the federal level. There was some fear that these kind of loans would disrupt federal mortgages. But essentially what the PACE loans are, a loan that you can get as a homeowner if you have equity in your house and you don't need to have a good credit score, you just need equity, and then you can get one of these loans to do energy efficiency or water conservation. You could add solar PV, potentially even some storage in your home. The cost of that gets tacked onto your mortgage as a lien. And then if you sell your home, then that all gets transferred to the next owner of that property. So you don't have to pay for it over the course of its entire life. You get to move on from it. So you get a lot of the upfront benefits of having a more holistic approach to your home while having the payments for it spread out over time and transferable to the next owner. And then beyond that, we've also got zero net energy or net zero energy in codes and standards in California and Oregon and Washington. And these are in the stretch codes in Oregon and Washington. In California, all new residential construction has to be zero net energy by 2020. All new commercial construction has to be net zero energy by 2030. And essentially, all this means is that over the course of an entire year, the amount of energy consumed by a facility is equal to the amount of energy that it produces. And so as a case study example, I'm just showing a little bit of Gresham's wastewater treatment plant. Gresham is a town abutting the eastern side of Portland. And their wastewater treatment plant, they went on about a 10-year journey to go net zero. And so this is from information that they reported out. They started out originally purchasing around 6,200 megawatt hours of electricity from their retail utility. They started out by adding biogas digester, and that knocked down their load quite a bit. And then they added in some more energy efficiency measures like blowers and whatnot to drop that load down even further. About halfway through their 10-year journey, they added a solar PV installation to the wastewater treatment plant, did some more energy efficiency, and then toward the end added a second biogas digester where they could charge people for bringing in their solid fatty wastes like from restaurants so they can earn some money by taking them, and then they put them into that biogas digester and make some money off of it. And so it took them 10 years to get down to net zero, and along the way, according to them, every investment that they made had a 5 to 7 year return on investment. So to hear some people tell it, it's quite a no-brainer for the treatment plant to go net zero. In the Pacific Northwest, I think a little over 2% of the total load of our region comes from wastewater treatment plants. And I'm sure not every wastewater treatment plant is going to be able to do this, but a lot of them can. And it's important to point out that net zero is not just going to be relegated to wastewater treatment. It cuts across all the industries and types of facilities. So we're expecting this to keep ratcheting down the load growth pressure over time. And then another contributing force to lower end-use loads is the fact that corporations are increasingly sourcing their own renewable power. And it's actually interesting right now, you know, you can see in this visual here from Rocky Mountain Institute, 2015, we saw a huge peak in commercial power purchase agreements between an end-use corporation and, you know, going around their utility and signing a power purchase agreement directly for some big offsite wind or solar system. And, you know, I think utilities started wisening up to what was going on and they got more aggressive in working with these corporate parties. So I think right now what we're seeing is kind of a dual trend. You know, on one hand, you've got an increase in corporate players that are going around their utility to secure deals for renewables. And on the other hand, you have an increase in corporate players that are working through their utilities to incorporate more renewables. Either way, it's become pretty clear that corporations are definitely interested in procuring renewable energy and cleaning up their own power profiles and their own business. So we're seeing a lot of activity here, and we're going to keep tracking that as well.